اور علامہ اقبال نے شاید یہ شعر کہا ہے بہت خوب کہ خیرہ نہ کر سکا مجھے جلوہ دانش فرنگ سرما ہے میری آنکھ میں خاک مدینہ و نجف. میری مراد پروفیسر سید حسیب الدین قادری صاحب سے ہے. سر جو ہے اگرچہ انگلش لٹریچر پڑھتے پڑھاتے ہیں پورے فرنگی جو ہے وہ تھیوریز کو اور ان کے جو نظریات کو پڑھ رکھا ہے لیکن آج بھی آنکھوں میں مدینہ سجا ہے اور دل میں رسول کی محبت بیٹھی ہے. بڑے ادب و احترام کے ساتھ سر آپ سے درخواست کرتا ہوں کہ میسج اپنا میلاد سر ڈیلیور کریں.
السلام علیکم. الحمد للہ رب العالمین، الصلاۃ والسلام علی سید المرسلین وعلی آلہ وصحابہ اجمعین، اما بعد فاعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم، بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم. محمد رسول اللہ، صدق اللہ مولانا العظیم وصدق رسوله النبی الکریم. آنریبل وائس چانسلر پروفیسر ڈاکٹر محمد اسلم پرویز صاحب، مولانا ڈاکٹر سید علی مشرف جائسی صاحب، پروفیسر مشتاق پٹیل صاحب، پروفیسر احتشام خان صاحب، آل دی پروفیسرز ہو آر دیر ان دی آڈینس، مائی ڈیئر کولیگز اینڈ مائی ڈیئر اسٹوڈینٹس، فسٹ آف آل آئی ووڈ لائک ٹو ایکسٹینڈ دی میلاد گریٹنگ. دین آئی ووڈ لائک ٹو کم ٹو دی انٹروڈکشن دیٹ آئی یوژلی میک ان انگلش، بٹ بفور دیٹ انٹروڈکشن آئی تھاٹ دیٹ آئی شوڈ ریسائٹ فیو ورسز ان پریز آف ہولی میجسٹی پروفیٹ محمد صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم، پرٹیکولرلی when I happened to listen to my predecessor's speech and the naat, the eulogy that people made in the praise of Holy Majesty Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Koi apni haqeeqat se yahan aakar gureza hain, چھپانے خود کو پردہ میم کا ہے، شکل انسان ہے. وہ سجدہ نور کو تھا یا کہ تھا مٹی کے پتلے کو، سمجھنے والے سمجھے، بے خبر اب تک کے غلطاں ہیں. وہاں 40 تھے 900 برس کی محنتوں کا پھل، یہاں 63 برس میں اجدہا میں سرفروشاں ہیں. وہاں پر عورتیں تھیں، عورتوں نے انگلیاں کاٹیں، یہاں سرکٹانے کو ہجوم میں ہوش مندہ ہیں. وہاں پورا جسد تھا آگ میں تب آگ ٹھنڈی تھی، یہاں کپڑے کی دھجی کو بھی چھونے آگ لرزاں ہیں. وہاں اقبار کا جلوہ اور کسی کے ارتقاء کی حد، وہاں اقبار کا جلوہ اور کسی کے ارتقاء کی حد، یہاں قوسین سے کم فاصلہ ہے، عقل حیران ہے. دی ریالٹی آف ہولی میجسٹی پروفیٹ محمد صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم از نور، اینڈ اٹ از دی گریس آف لارڈ آل مائٹی اللہ دیٹ ہی سینٹ ہم ایز اے مرسی ان ہیومن فارم. Keep this particular statement registered in your brains. Then I'll move on to the tamheed. I have slightly changed because of the thoughts that struck me as I was listening to all those people who were in reality praising Holy Majesty Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Praise is due to Allah, whose worth cannot be described by speakers, whose bounties cannot be counted by reckoners, whose claim to obedience cannot be satisfied by those who attempt to do so, whom the height of intellectual courage cannot appreciate, the diving of understanding cannot reach, he for whose description no limit is laid down, no eulogy exists, no duration is fixed. Lord Almighty Allah sent Holy Majesty Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in fulfillment of his promise, in completion of the prophethood. Dear friends, one important thing that you need to remember is the reality of Holy Majesty Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was Hazrat Jabir who happened to visit the court of the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked him, O Prophet of Allah, what is it that Lord Almighty Allah created before the creation of all the things? The reply was, O Jabir, Lord Almighty Allah created before the creation of all the things the light of your Prophet from his own light. Then he created the light of the entire universe. And this particular hadith was narrated by one of famous traditionist known as Abdul Razzaq, who happened to be the student of Imam Malik and who happened to be the teacher of Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal. Dear friends, from here I would like to come to that verse of Holy Quran whose implementation we are doing today. In Surah Yunus, verse 58, Lord Almighty Allah says, قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ فَبِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَهُ هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. Tell, he was addressing his beloved Holy Majesty Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that if you want to rejoice, if you want to celebrate, then celebrate the fazl and rahmat of Lord Almighty Allah. And nobody would disagree with me when I say that the perfect fazl and the perfect rahmat of Lord Almighty Allah is the personality and the person and the being of Holy Majesty Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we are in reality obeying the command of Lord Almighty Allah by celebrating this particular rahmat of Lord Almighty Allah. Just now you heard, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. Indeed, he has been sent as a mercy to all the world. There are plenty of things which are of great significance. Please send Ruhi Sharif in the court of Holy Majesty. Allahumma sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Aap switch off kar dijiye. And the purpose of this particular celebration is what I am going to talk about. And if you look at the topic that I gave you, the message of Milad, this is the same topic that I keep using for all the celebrations that have been made in this particular university. Today I would like to discuss about a particular concept which is of great significance. You're in reality spending your time in a university, and the purpose of your stay here is to acquire knowledge. Rather, there are plenty of objectives and purposes of the universities, but the main objective is to actually acquire knowledge. Or today you talk about universities becoming the citadels of creation of knowledge. The concept has changed a little. It is just not the means to acquire knowledge, but it has become the place where you're supposed to create knowledge. But this is what I would like you to always keep in mind. Knowledge does not mean, or rather I should put it like this, possessing knowledge does not mean that you're guided. Guidance is different, knowledge is different. Possessing knowledge does not mean that you're guided. In order to understand this, you just think about the information that you possess. The information that you possess, say about some truth. But unless and until you put that truth into practice, that is to say, you yourself become truthful, you cannot consider yourself to be guided one. So if you know the truth, it doesn't mean that you are truthful. So if you possess knowledge, it doesn't mean that you are guided. You are knowledgeable, perfectly all right, but you are not guided. And this particular event, in reality, is organized to actually tell you what guidance is all about. Here I am taking guidance to be enlightenment. And this is, in reality, the purpose of our celebration of the birthday of the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Where can you get the guidance? And I tell you, you can get guidance only in the life of Holy Majesty Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you want to be guided one, then you need to actually look at the life of the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There are moments in your life also where you can actually feel that guidance in you. For example, if you speak truth, how would you feel? I can actually tell you the day, the instant, the moment, or at any occasion when you speak the truth, in reality you are showing that you are guided. When you show honesty, in reality you are showing that you are guided. When you help people, in reality you are showing that you are guided. When you stop yourself from committing any kind of wicked activity, evil activity, sinful activity, then take it that you are actually in the state of being guided. When you refrain from backbiting, mudslinging, take it that you are guided. When you do not want to assassinate somebody's character unnecessarily, take it you are guided. And this is the message that I am giving you from the life and through the life of Holy Majesty Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Those of you who had this honor of studying minutely every aspect of the life of Holy Majesty Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they'll vouch for me that never ever the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke untruth. In fact, his title was Amin, the trustworthy, the honest, known to be man of integrity. And I ask you one thing. Those of you who had this honor of reading different biographies of the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I ask them, it's a rhetorical question, I'll answer also. When are the obligatory worships or praise are made obligatory or mandatory on you? Everybody would say that after the migration of the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Medina. Before that, there was hardly any prayer which was made obligatory on you. Salah, namaz, when Holy Majesty Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had the honor of meeting Lord Almighty Allah in Mi'raj, it was 12th year according to one particular tradition of the Nubuwa, or the invitation. At that time he received the 5 times prayer, and he actually prescribed after coming from there. Before that, it was not obligatory. I'm talking about the obligatory prayers. When was zakat, hajj, fasting? They were all prescribed when the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated to Medina. That is to say, 13 years after his call to invitation. Then what was it that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was using to attract people towards Islam? Only his character, only his honesty, only his truth, only stopping people from committing any kind of injustice. These were the things that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam were presenting before the people. He was asking them, come to the unity of Allah, oneness of Lord Almighty Allah. And along with that, he was asking them how to treat your parents, how you should actually serve your mother, your father. He was asking people how to help the poor and the needy and the downtrodden and the ones who are wrong. I tell you, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had not yet declared his prophethood, made any announcement of his prophethood. He was just 20 years old. You pick up any seerah, you will find this particular incident. It is said that once one Yemeni, he came to Mecca to do some business. And in Mecca, there used to be quite a few tribes. 10 tribes were very famous of Mecca. And there was one particular chief of these tribes, one of these tribes known as As ibn Wail, ferocious enemy of Islam later. But remember, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was 20 years old. And this Yemeni had come, As ibn Wail bought some goods from him and refused to pay him. Say, I won't, do whatever you feel like. There was no law, there was nothing there. The tribes were actually halif of one another. They used to support one another. Nobody dared to speak against was then. This man, he did not know what to do. He actually went to the holy Kaaba. He stood in the sanctuary and he started shouting, "Oh people who are there to help me, I'm a stranger in your land. How could you take away my goods and do not return me anything in return?" It is said that the son of Hazrat Abdul Muttalib, the uncle of Holy Majesty Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Hazrat Zubair ibn Abdul Muttalib, he was the one who actually thought that this is a terrible thing that we are doing. People come and do some commerce with us, but we are depriving them of their rightful return. Then what happened was, there was a meeting in the house of Abdullah ibn Jad'an, a very generous man of those times. They all went there and they decided, as long as there is the water in the sea and the water has the capacity to wet things, we will support every victim, every person who was wrong. We will speak against every injustice. We will support every wronged person, every troubled soul. And they came to Mecca and they made the vow. This is known as helpful fuzul. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was one of those who actually was the one who made this vow. Long after this, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was inviting people towards the fold of Islam, he remembered this. He said that today also, if anybody invites me towards such kind of alliance of justice, I will be first person to join it. And it is said that while he was 20 years old, he actually had a group of young men. And wherever the Prophet of Allah saw any kind of injustice, wherever he saw people are being wronged, he would go along with these young men and in reality support the victim and get the victim the right from the oppressor. This was what the Prophet of Allah did, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when you come to the life of the Prophet of Allah, indeed, that every action of the Prophet of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in reality, is a means and a source for us to be guided. Look at the life of the Prophet of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was migration only. And how people trusted him, you have to keep that thing in mind. You all knew this event of hijrat, migration, and the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave valuables to Maulana Ali. He said, you keep these valuables, people have entrusted these valuables with me, you return these and you also march after returning all these, trust all these valuables to the respective people. And what happened? Hazrat Ali did that. But here I would like to highlight one particular aspect. Who are the people there in Makkah at that time? Were Muslims there? No. All the Muslims have migrated to Medina. There were quite a few Muslims who had migrated to Abyssinia. Two migrations had taken place before the migration of Medina. Hardly any Muslim was there in Makkah. So whose valuables were there? They were the valuables of the infidels of Makkah, the pagans of Makkah, who actually gathered round, encircled the house of the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to assassinate him, to kill. But look at the kind of trust that they had with the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They did not keep their valuables with their own people. They kept the valuables with the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What does it suggest? That these people in reality are insinuating, conveying is one thing. What is that? They are not believing in the message of the Prophet of Allah. They did not believe in the message, but they believe in the character of the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And what kind of a Muslims are we today? We believe in his message, but what happened to us? We are not ready to believe in his person, in his character. This is what you have to think. And this is what I see all the time. I tell you, I was talking about the prayers. All these prayers, most of them were made obligatory when the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated from Makkah to Medina. But all these other things, for example, speaking truth, being honest, helping people, so on and so forth, keeping the promises, honoring the promises, so on and so forth, they were all different forms of worship. If you think they aren't, then you're mistaken. They are worship. Every good deed that you carry out in reality is a worship to Lord Almighty Allah. And that's what the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us. Would you forget that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in respect of serving mothers, you all knew this, he said, underneath the feet of your mother lies Jannah. Everybody quotes this. What does it mean? Serve your mother, ensure Jannah for yourself. This is what it means. I'm reminded of one particular, there are people who may disagree, there is this tradition, but I would like you to pay attention to this tradition. You must have heard the name of Uwais al-Qarani. This particular being had love for Holy Majesty Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to an unbelievable extent. His only wish in life seemed to be just to look at the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But his mother would not leave him. She was old and he had to actually take care of her. And whenever he passed this message to the Prophet of Allah, he was actually instructed by the Prophet, serve your mother. This is important. And he kept serving his mother. But one day it so happened, his mother gave him permission, go. You can go, but there is one condition from me. You should not get down from the conveyance. Probably it was horse or camel, whatever the conveyance, whatever the mount that he actually had at the time. She said that you should not get down. You just salam and return. And Hazrat Uwais, he came to Medina. Traditions had it. But when he entered Medina, he found that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had gone away from Medina. He was actually defending the faith in the Medina, so on and so forth, probably the Battle of Uhud. Hazrat Uwais, since he had promised his mother, he returned. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after coming back from the battle, happened to pass by from the place where Uwais had actually stayed for some time. Then the Prophet of Allah, please notice this statement of the Prophet. Make it a complete note of it. He said it. I smell of Jannah, the place where Uwais stood. The Prophet of Allah happened to pass by from there. He said, I smell of Jannah. Did Uwais come here? What does it mean? The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam guaranteed Jannat for him. It is just not that. But he also smelt of Jannah. Why? Because this particular person served his mother so much that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could actually smell the smell of Jannah because of his arrival over there. I remember once it so happened, a Jewish person converted to Islam and he came in the court of the Prophet of Allah, said that, what should I do with my Jewish mother now? The Prophet of Allah replied that, what would you do? He said that she didn't embrace Islam, she remained Jew, and how could I treat her now? The Prophet of Allah said that, serve her doubly. Take care of her more than what you used to take care of. And then this man went to his house, he started taking care of his mother. So much so that one day she had to actually ask, why are you behaving like this? You seem to be completely changed. Why are you helping me so much? Then this man said that my Prophet said, underneath the feet of mother lies Jannah, and I am actually earning Jannah by helping you. Then she said, is this what your Prophet teaches? Let me see him. And I do not need to actually tell you what has happened later. This is what the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught. This is what we need to actually stick to. And this is the message that I am giving. I was talking about, I was talking about worship. And I thought that I should speak about these things. You see, you have two types of worships. The worships which are made obligatory on you, and the worships which are there in the form of your doing good. For Holy Majesty Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, I have come to perfect good manners, one. And he said that I have come to perfect good deeds. It is the completion and the perfection of good deeds that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said is his objective in coming to this world. Now, when I talked about two types of worship, you can have very many forms. I'm just segregating them for our understanding. One, offering prayer to Lord Almighty Allah five times, practicing charity, performing Hajj, keeping fast, so on and so forth. It's an obligatory. You have to do. And there are other. For example, you speak truth. This is a good deed. And every good deed in reality is a worship to Lord Almighty Allah. Being honest, good deed. Keeping yourself away from backbiting, slandering people, assassinating the characters of others, indeed, it's a good deed. I tell you, when you worship, the obligatory worship, you are preparing for the next world. These worships, in reality, will be rewarded. The reward will be in the next world. That doesn't mean I'm not restricting it. You will also have reward here. But the obvious understanding is that when you offer prayer to Lord Almighty Allah, when you keep fast, when you give zakat, when you perform Hajj, in reality, the reward is ensured for the world to come. Hereafter, next world. But when you speak truth, when you are honest, when you help people, when you sacrifice your need for the sake of others' needs, when you refrain yourself from wicked activity, from evil activity, the reward is there in this world itself. You can see by practicing these things that the reward will not only be given to you, but you will definitely find the blessings surrounding, encircling you. This is what you need to keep in mind. And this is the message that I am giving you. And it is important for all of us to actually think about this. These are the occasions which you need to utilize to the maximum. Rather, I should say that these are the occasions that maximize the opportunity to do good and minimize the opportunity to do bad. And your aim ought to be the pursuit of truth, honesty. Rather, you have actually got them. But through it, you actually get dignity. And this should be the purpose of every person. With these words, I conclude my talk. I have taken lots of time. But with a rangeeniya mehroma kehkashan, muskuraye nabi ho gaya mojiza. Vastu dhoman.
بہت شکریہ سر اس دلنشی خطاب کے لیے اور اب میں بڑے ادب احترام کے ساتھ دعوت دیتا ہوں جناب سمیع صاحب کو جو کہ اسسٹنٹ پروفیسر انگلش ڈپارٹمنٹ ہے کہ وہ آ کر کے ایک ہدیہ انعام پیش کریں
صدر مجلس کی اجازت سے نعت پاک کے دو تین شعر اور آپ سے اجازت نعت کا مطلب دیکھیں کہ مانگنے والوں نے مانگے ہیں ارم کے تحفے مانگنے والوں نے مانگے ہیں ارم کے تحفے ہم کو مطلوب ہیں بس شاہ امم کے تحفے ہم کو مطلوب ہیں بس شاہ امم کے تحفے اور ہو گئی پوری دعا حضرت آدم خوش ہیں ہو گئی پوری دعا حضرت آدم خوش ہیں ان کو جب سے ہیں ملے نور خدم کے تحفے ان کو جب سے ہیں ملے نور خدم کے تحفے اور شعر یہ ہے کہ پہلے کمزور جو تھی اس کی بھی رفتار بڑی پہلے کمزور جو تھی اس کی بھی رفتار بڑی اونٹنی پائی جب آخا کے قدم کے تحفے اونٹنی پائی جب آخا کے قدم کے تحفے اور شعر یہ ہے کہ فتح مکہ ہوا آخا نے بنائی تاریخ فتح مکہ ہوا آخا نے بنائی تاریخ دشمنوں میں کیے تقسیم کرم کے تحفے دشمنوں میں کیے تقسیم کرم کے تحفے اور آپ پر کیوں نہ ہو قربان دلو جا میرے آپ پر کیوں نہ ہو قربان دلو جا میرے آپ نے دیر کو دلوائے حرم کے تحفے آپ نے دیر کو دلوائے حرم کے تحفے اور یہ مقطع کہ نعت کی بزم میں حاضر ہے نعیم ناچیز نعت کی بزم میں حاضر ہے نعیم ناچیز ابن ثابت کے ہیں یہ نقش قدم کے تحفے ابن ثابت کے ہیں یہ نقش قدم کے تحفے